So I thought he'd give you a...
Oh, wow.
Sharon.
Okay, so let's keep going with this. We're at the free response problems at the on page 3.
Bless you.
Hey, thank you all so much. Free response problems, question 1. A petition of 500 signatures is submitted to the school principal. Principal would like to check the petition for unregistered students and fake names. There is not enough time to check the entire list. I would contend that there probably is, but that's neither here nor there. There should be one in the book over there. So the idea is, how do you use a nest? So it says, how do you create a sample of 30 signatures? Interestingly enough, this doesn't say an SRS of 30 signatures, nor does it say a random sample of 30 signatures. So I suppose if you were really trying to make a point, you could just say, pick the first 30 signatures on the list. Because that is a sample, but yeah, that is a convenient sample. It doesn't say to use a simple random sample. It doesn't say to use a random sample at all.
So if you explain that convenient sample well enough, you can get that point.
So
if it doesn't specify, you can do whatever you want.
You know, I wouldn't. I would always do a simple random sample. I would always do an SRS. Okay, I'm trying to explain it. Although it doesn't say that you have to use a simple random sample, It doesn't say that you have to use a random sample at all. I would still use a simple random sample. Okay. Don't try to outsmart the test. Try to show that you know exactly what is being asked. So we're gonna use a simple SRS. Use an SRS. Now, sample, there are 500 signatures to choose from. So that is a large number of people. It's gonna be kind of cumbersome to give each of those 500 signatures a unique ID number from one to say 100,000 or five digits. So I think probably the best way to do this is to use sequential numbering. So number slash ID the signatures sequentially from 1 to 500.
Connie Lopez, please report to the main office. Your mother is waiting. Connie Lopez, report to the main
office. Use a random number generator. To select, is it 30? Yeah, 30 ID numbers. Slash signatures for the sample. Okay. That would be the easiest thing to do in this case. I'm trying to lead you all to believe that using random ID numbers is the way that you want to do things for most of the time. And if you use a random ID here, I'm not going to argue with you. Perfectly fine. Nothing wrong with it. But I think practicality speaking, this is what you'd want to do. Brett? Right. But the idea is if you use an SRS, and that's actually a really good point. But the idea is if you use an SRS and you find that, let's just say, you know, two or three out of the 30 names that you picked were fake, then your estimate would be approximately 10% of the names on the list are fake. One out of 30, I don't know what one out of 30 would break down to, less than 5%. So less than 5% of the names are fake. Which is really the basis of statistics as a practice.
Would you want us to know how many people signed the
test? Yeah, absolutely.
Do you think you could go over that?
Sure. For the SRS.
Do we need a calculator more?
You shouldn't, but you can have it. So what is it? It's under math. Probability. Rand int. And that's low, comma high. And that would give you a random number. Rand int. The first number is a low number, so usually 1. The second number is a high number, so in this case 500. 1 comma 500 parentheses.
So on a similar question like this,
It's not that I won't accept it. It's just that in certain situations, making a reference to the calculator doesn't count for anything. Okay.
Thank you.
All right, question two.
What button is PRC?
It's a soft menu in the across the top. Okay. The size of a tip a waiter receives is determined in part by the server's behavior. In an experiment, a waiter will flip a coin to decide whether to stand or squat next to the table. Ooh. I feel very uncomfortable if my waiter is squatting. The waiter would record the amount of the bill and the tip that they received when he stood or squatted. Describe the treatment and the response variables. Okay. So treatment. Stand or squat, right? We're not there yet. What's next? Response. Size of the tip. Is that right? Size of the tip? Amount of tip? Okay. And that's for A. B. Describe any extraneous factors and how they could be controlled. So is there anything that's going to affect the amount of tip, but is not part of the experiment as yet? So let's go Daisy and Brown. How much money is spent? Good. So it could be size of the bill. Size of the bill. How can you control that?
By having everybody order the same thing.
Are like telling them all like a special?
Well, like just like if they
pick
one of your sample that ordered like $40, like a specific.
Was that?
Like measure only like include people in your sample that ordered like just ordered a certain amount of $40.
Only include bills. Of a certain dollar amount? Say $40 to $60. That's pretty typical, right? Yeah, Bernard?
What about the type of food that they eat?
Okay. Is that going to affect the bill or the tip? The kind of food that the person orders?
They may, like, you know, for example, like whoever's eating, they may feel satisfied, they may increase the tip that they give.
So the type of food that they order?
Yeah.
Okay. So if we believe that that's going to, like the size of the bill, if we believe that's going to affect the tip, we should control for that. So the type of food order, how would you control that? Well, I mean, that's not the idea. The idea here is, like, if we believe that the type of food ordered is going to affect the tip, how do we make sure that everybody is kind of ordering the same, right?
Only include the bill on the same type of food.
Okay, so only include... of the same type? I.e., Okay. Any other things?
Like the amount of salary, like the amount of money a person makes for a living, because they don't have as much money, they can possibly tip less because they don't have as much money they get.
Okay.
It would be like salary. Like,
so a bit. I'm not sure that's something you can control. That's something that you would probably take care of with randomization.
Yeah.
Let's get yours.
Okay. the type of behavior he has when he comes to the table, because like he can like control it by like acting the same way to every table he comes to.
Okay, so you're saying behavior of the waiter? Behavior of the waiter could definitely affect the size of the tip, so you'd have to make sure that
he acts the same way to everyone.
That behavior is consistent. Okay, and we, if you have one more.
Size of the party.
Size of the party, that's a really good one actually.
Table location.
Size of the party. Let me finish with this one and then we'll get to that. So what would you do to control size of party?
Compare the bills that are from big party and like small party.
Well, I mean, take a look at what we're doing here. When we say control, that means that we're only going to take, we have to like make sure that that variable is consistent. So how do you make sure that they're consistent?
You compare the ratio of the tip to amount of people.
Well, that's changing our response now. So, Griff?
Well, I think what would solve a lot of problems is doing this, is find the percent tip instead of the amount of the dollar amount.
Use percent tip. Okay.
Like, compared to food order.
And that changes our response variable, is what that changes. That doesn't change this part right here. Okay, so limit only include. Does everyone, you kind of see what I mean by control now?
Yeah.
Take all these variables and set some restrictions on them to ensure some kind of consistency. So only include bills from parties, what did we say, four or less? And I think that's enough.
Yeah, does it matter how many, events you put that you can control, like, a certain amount, like, if you want?
In an actual experiment, you're going to want to locate and control as many variables as you can think of. Yeah. If we were actually going to do it. If you're going to do it on the test, one or two is okay. Pick the best one. My favorite one here is size of the party. I think that really affects the size of the tip. I don't know. I've never never done food service, or I've never done wait staff like in a restaurant, so don't know. Yeah.
Would rate of service also be one?
Rate of service.
How fast they serve.
How fast? Yeah, that would definitely be one as well. So you'd have to control that also. Make sure that you serve the food consistently. C, discuss whether blocking would be necessary. Okay, so now this is where we would get into a lot of these things. So I'm sorry, what was the one? I forgot your name.
Justin,
what was the one that you said earlier?
About blocking?
Yeah, no, about the, was yours the size of the bill or was that something else? No.
It was size of party and table location.
Size of party and table location, yeah. So that's something that you can take care of with blocking as well. Okay, because you can't, if it's hard to control it, then you can block it. Okay?
Wait, could you, are you saying block it, one block of party is 3 to 4, and the other block of party is 1 to 2?
Yeah. We're saying we're going to separate them into separate mini experiments because we know that there's going to be variation. Okay? Another popular one that people, I don't know if this is going to be the same thing as yours, but another one that people have given over the years is the lunch crowd versus the dinner crowd. People are going to tip differently whether they're ordering for lunch, in which case they just want to get the hell out of there, or if they're ordering for dinner, in which case they might be on a date and they're trying to impress their date, something like that. So you might want to block based, separate the into the shift. You could also control that by ensuring that all of it comes from the same shift as well.
I don't really think that's necessary to block it. I would just keep it under the SRS and the controls that we just said.
Okay.
You don't have to block it.
If you're actually making an experiment, you should do whatever you can to make sure that all of these variables are controlled, and that might include blocking. So blocking might be necessary, right? Necessary for the experiment.
But all we have to say, we don't have to explain.
No, we're not done yet.
Oh, okay. So you can say yes or no.
For example,
like the dinner rush or the lunch.
Yeah. We might need to block. Let me finish this and then we'll get to that, okay? We might need to block according to dinner shift or lunch shift, since this is a known source of variability. Yeah, what were you saying?
What's the exact definition of blocking?
Blocking is separating the subjects into groups according to known sources of variability.
Mm-hmm. Blocking, it will also account for any lurking variables.
They're not really lurking if you know what they are. Like,
could the like dinner and lunch shifts also be a type of the extraneous factors?
Yeah. Yeah, you could also control dinner and lunch. Mm-hmm. Certainly possible as well. Mm-hmm. Okay. D, identify possible confounding variables. And, you know, that's funny because that's all we've done so far is identify confounding variables. Okay, so everything identified so far has been a confounding variable. I'm sorry? A confounding variable is any variable that's going to affect the response. Okay. Or maybe I should say any variable that's not the explanatory variable yet also affects the response. So let's go in the back and then well, that's not really a variable, though. That's not some external thing that's going to affect our response. You know?
Okay.
You said that affects the what?
Response. Okay. So what did we say? A confounding variable is any variable that is not the explanatory variable, but affects the response.
What's the explanatory variable?
Explanatory variable is the purported cause, or the what you think is the cause.
What would be the cause?
In this case, we want the cause to be whether the waiter sits or squats. I'm sorry, stands or squats. Yeah. Not necessarily. There are some things that you cannot block. You know.
But we can use like a lot of them, like the size of the parts.
Yeah.
But on your test, can we say that everything identified so far? Like, we can't say that on a test.
Well, this is one of those questions where this isn't really going to be a test question the way it is.
It's just tough.
Yeah.
Two questions. So, like, the explanatory variable is the treatment in essence.
Yes.
Good.
And the extraneous variable and confounding variable, their definitions are sort of kind of overlapped.
Yeah. Yeah.
What's the difference between the extraneous and confounding variable?
Well, an extraneous variable does not necessarily have an effect on the response. Or a confounding variable has an effect on the response.
The tree there exists. It's just there.
Yeah. Okay. We run into problems when our extraneous variables are confounding as well. Okay. Anything else with question two? Are we okay now with the a lot of these concepts? Response, confounding, locking. Okay, three was the Pismo Beach one. We didn't talk about this in period four. But Pismo Beach, California holds the annual clam chowder contest. Judges rate clam chowder from local restaurants. 1 year, Denny's clam chowder was declared the winner. And we talked about how I went to Splash Cafe. It's interesting. Neither my wife nor my in-laws like clam chowder. So I was the only one in there with the clam chowder. I don't even particularly like clam chowder either, but. But there are certain places where you will eat clam chowder. Pismo's one of them. Boston's another one.
San Francisco.
San Francisco's another one, yeah. Was that? Yeah. Okay, judges participated in a blind taste test. What does a blind taste test mean? I'd be careful with that phraseology because there will always be bias. The idea is to reduce bias, not to eliminate bias. Yes. The judges do not know which clam chowder they were sampling. Okay. That means the containers. Sharon. Feel rather comfortable, actually. This means containers were unmarked. Yeah. No marks to identify the restaurant of origin. Big disclaimer on this one is that even though we're saying that there are no marks to identify the restaurant of origin, that doesn't mean that does not mean that the samples had no identifying marks on them at all. Most likely they just had a serial number or an ID number, and they would only be known as, this is cup of soup number two. This is cup of soup number three. Yeah, this is what it is, blind sample. Do you think judges, Denny's would have won if this was not blind? Most likely not. Not have won. Yeah, since... Denny's restaurant. Denny's Diner. When you have no choice. Denny's is the place you go when you have no choice.
You just see the people. Like, I went there one night at like 3. You just see the people that are in there. It's so weird.
Yeah, people like you.
Because people don't have a choice.
Yeah.
It's so weird.
Yeah.
No,
it's not the diner of choice, it's the diner of no choice. Since Denny's Diner has a reputation,
Sometimes I do homework there.
An established. Has an established reputation. Okay, I think that's enough here, right? What just happened? We usually stop around 5:30. I have nothing against Denny's, other than there is no choice in the matter. Okay, let's go to question four. This looks like a lot of fun. Like I said, this looks like a lot of fun. This is from a research at University of Pennsylvania. Why would I make up research? You think I'm some kind of a monster?
No.
Okay, let's see. Researchers at University of Pennsylvania would like to see if a nasal spray is beneficial in relieving symptoms of premenstrual syndrome, PMS.
What?
The experimenters would like an experiment, the spray, with a control group. Since the effectiveness of the spray may vary by weight of the subject, experimenters plan to use a matched pair similar group design. There are 40 subjects available for this experiment. Sketch a diagram for the design of this experiment.
Be like walking?
No.
Oh, okay.
Definitely not a block. So it says to sketch this, right?
Yeah, that's why I thought it would be walking.
So what I would like to do is rather, we'll sketch it also, but I also want to write a summary of how to do this, okay? So the very first thing is to do is we're going to match, or we're going to pair our subjects. First, pair the subjects by similar weight. For example, if Mrs. Ferreira weighs 102 pounds, then she's going to be paired with someone else who weighs around 102 pounds. I don't know why I'm picking Mrs. Freya. I mean, I did already, but, you know. She never lets me live it down either. Anyways, so we're gonna pair them by similar weight. And then after we do that, with match pair similar groups, there's usually only two groups. And the easiest way to SRS that is to flip a coin. Okay. Flip a coin to separate each pair. Into two groups, i.e. heads will go into group one. Until one group has 20 subjects. No. You don't even have to do that, actually. What am I saying? So we're going to do this, we're going to flip the coin 20 times because we have 20 pairs. Okay? We have 20 pairs, we're going to separate them 20 times. Okay? Group 1 will use the nasal spray, while group 2 uses a placebo spray. You don't have to specify exactly what that placebo spray will be. Probably like saline or something. You get to spray saline in your nose. That's awesome.
What is it?
Do you think it'll work?
It's a spray that like isn't actually real. Like it doesn't have any medical components to it. It's just like
fake medicine. Okay. After use of spray, compare effects of PMS. I don't know, are we looking at the effects of PMS?
Then compare the behavior.
Oh, the symptoms. Symptoms of PMS. Okay. Okay, so let's draw a diagram. Let's diagram this out. Okay, so we're going to take our 40 subjects. Okay, 20 pairs.
Is that like walking? Because you're walking by their way?
No, I already asked.
Oh, it's matching my hair.
If I wait, then we're going to SRS them. Group one. Okay. Let me get to that in 1 second then, okay? 20 subjects. This is going to be treatment one. Nasal spray. Treatment two. Placebo. And then we're going to compare PMS. Can't tell you how excited I am to be able to say PMS this many times in one afternoon.
He's joking.
I know. Sharon, you've been in the class for over a year, and you still think I'm serious every time I say these things. Yes, sir.
What does it say on the group one? 20
subjects? Subjects, yeah. It's my fancy way of abbreviating subjects. So was there a question that I kind of dismissed?
Yeah. I thought that this was blocking.
Uh-huh.
What's blocking?
Okay, so in a block design...
That's the one that, like, you have the random allocation?
Yeah. They all have random allocation.
Okay.
Is
that SRS? That's simple
random allocation. Yeah, SRS would be your random sampling allocation, and I would always, instead of write random allocation, I would just write SRS. But for a block design, you have to separate them into two groups first, and then do an SRS.
Okay, so if we were to do it with this, it would go like 20 people, 20 people SRS into the two subcategories?
Well, no, see, we're not...
But
wait.
Like, we wouldn't do it with this, obviously, but
if we were going to block,
yeah.
Block 1, 20, block 2, 20, SRS, treatment 1, treatment 2.
Treatment 1, treatment 2. Okay. And then compare. Okay.
So it's going to look, a block design looks like two experiments being run at the same time.
Okay. And can you just give me an example of like, when we would use that?
We use block design whenever there is an unavoidable source of variability that was difficult to control.
So like, say like, if there's boys and girls.
Yes. We can't really control like boys and girls.
Okay.
You know, we can, to the detriment of our study, we can say only boys will be in our study or only girls will be in our study. But if you want to include both boys and girls in our study and we know it makes a difference, then we have to block for it. Okay. Yeah.
So the 20 pairs by weight, is it just the higher weight and lower weight?
Well, you know, I you know, like I said, if I had a young lady who weighed 112 pounds, I don't know why I'm picking like these really super light girls.
160 pound
girl, right? And we would find another girl that weighs approximately 160 pounds, pair them together, and then separate the pair. I'm probably glad I didn't hear that, aren't I? Okay, that's awesome. Great. Any other questions with five? Sharon?
On the AP test, can you write down, like, I know we're not going to do like this, but can you write down SRS and we'll understand what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay, awesome, cool.
Officially recognized term. No, we didn't. We've been like, you know, shooting the breeze, talking the talk, chilling. Number five, can we make a better Powerpuff Girl? Professor Utonium decides to make an experiment where with two levels of sugar and spice, everything in nice, and two levels of chemical X, X1 and X2, to see if he can improve upon Blossom Bubbles and Buttercup. Professor Utonium would like a completely randomized design to test a girl's superpowers. We have 50 subjects available for this experiment. What are we supposed to do? Apparently we're supposed to diagram this. Okay, so let's diagram this. How many treatments do we have?
There's four.
There are four treatments, very good. Four treatment groups. Four treatment groups. Sugar, spice, and everything nice one, together with chemical X1. Sugar, spice, everything nice one with X2.
Sugar, spice, everything nice.
Sugar, spice, everything nice, combination 2 with chemical X1. And sugar, spice, everything nice 2 combined with chemical X2. So we have four treatment groups. We're going to randomly allocate into four treatment groups. This did say completely randomized design, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So completely randomized design. We're going to have 50 subjects. And we're going to SRS them into, guess what? Four groups. Do you see the problem?
Yeah. Yeah, 50 doesn't divide by 4.
Very nice. So how many people are we going to have in the groups then?
They're going to be uneven.
They're going to be uneven, good. Doesn't matter. They should be around the same. Okay. So how many people do you want in group one?
12.
12 subjects. How many in group two?
13.
Sure, 13 subjects. Group three?
12.
We have no choice. That must be 12 subjects, right? It doesn't matter which one gets 13, which one gets 12. Not really. Okay, so this is going to receive treatment one, which is going to be SSE1 with X1. These are going to be treatment 2, SSE1 with X2. These are going to be treatment 3, SSE2 with X1. And this is going to be treatment 4, SSE2 together with X2.
Did you do 12, 13, 13, 12 because it adds up to 50?
Yes.
I think I did it like evenly distributed.
As evenly as possible. Compare, what are we comparing? Superpowers? Yeah, I don't know what a better Powerpuff Girl is.
A better Powerpuff Girl.
Stop right there.
Okay. Any questions on those free response ones that we just did, numbers 1 through 5? Match pair is where we take our subjects and, there are two different kinds of match pair designs. Okay. In the first kind, we take our subjects, we pair them together based on some similar confounding variable. And then we break them into, we separate the pair into the groups randomly. And then in an own control, each subject is going to be used or undergo the treatment and multiple treatments, and we use randomization to decide which treatment it goes in which order.
Thank you, Mr. Ryan.
You're welcome. Yeah.
For that question, we had to draw it, right? We didn't have to summarize it.
No, I don't think it said to summarize. I don't want to.
Sit down and get tough.
Only if it's, well, you're always going to have to summarize. This is just kind of being instructive.
Oh, okay.
Can
not as much of a test question. We should summarize this now, right? So summarize. Okay. We're going to use an SRS to create 4 groups. So this is, say, 2 groups. I only have this one.
Okay.
2 groups of 12. Okay. Group 1 will receive, and I'm going to cut and paste here. Group 2 Group 3 will receive, and group 4 will receive this treatment. Mm-hmm. After treatment, Powerpuff Girls will be compared. Okay. So the completely randomized design is the most basic experiment. There is no blocking, no matching, no pairing.
Is the question going to be as simple
I hope so.
I hope so too.
Like, I don't know already.
Questions are going to be on the test?
Huh?
How many questions are going to be on?
Approximately 10 and 2.
10 and 2.
Approximately 10 and 2. 10 multiple choice and 2 free response.
Oh.
How? Magic?
No, there's like 6
people. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, how magic? How many people you said magic?
Some of you are going to be kicked out into another classroom.
Are they making us another staff class?
That's the rumor. Yeah, that's pretty much what's gonna happen.
I don't want that.
I don't. Yeah, I'm staying out of it.
Well, I think they are.
Hmm. I can't pick who's gonna stay and who's gonna go.
I can't go.
If they pick you, I'm gonna say take her, please.
Wait, is there gonna be another teacher?
Huh?
It's
gonna be Mr. Valerio.
Wait, when are they? I don't want to.
Period 2, I think.
I can't do that.
I can't.
You're gonna switch like the English math class.
I have no idea.
You don't choose who goes.
I don't. Okay, let's move on. We are going to look at the multiple choice now.
So we're doing FRC number 3 in 2005.
Yeah, we're going to do that tomorrow in class. Let's look at question 6. We're pretty much in the final lap here. Your company has developed a new treatment for acne. You think men and women might react differently to the medication. So again, that's key for an unavoidable source of variation. So you're going to separate them into two groups. Those groups, of course, are called blocks. The men are randomly assigned to two groups, and the women are then assigned to two groups. One of the two groups will be given medication. The other one is given a placebo. This is a blocked design. So it's comparative randomization blocked by gender. So B, this is a blocked design. Okay. Comparative. Randomized design refers to all the designs that we've studied. In other words, completely randomized design, block design, match pair design, all three of those are comparative randomized designs. Okay. So that's really not saying anything. Stratified by gender is an incorrect usage. Stratify has nothing to do with design. Stratification is how do you randomize. And that's not even how we randomize. That's a randomization method. Randomize, block by gender, and type of medication. We are not blocking by type of medication. Type of medication is an explanatory variable. We do not block by explanatory variables. And no, this is not a match pair design. So this is a blocked design. What do we say? Comparative randomized block design. Questions on that one? Nice.
Is that all we write?
Multiple choice. Not for number 7. Yeah. Oh. There'll be approximately 10 multiple choice questions and 2 free response questions.
Thank you.
And I think that's the 4th time I've said that this afternoon.
So
I swear to God, if you ask me how many multiple choice questions.
He's giving you your F right now.
What would it be a comparative randomized?
What wouldn't be?
Yeah.
It's B.
That would be something like a case study, which we don't talk about in this class. I'd rather not go into it. Yeah. Okay, 7. Double-blind design is important in an experiment because, A, there is a natural tendency for subjects in experiment to want to please the researcher. That's true. B, it helps control for the placebo effect. That's interesting. But it's kind of true. Kind of lets you know that the placebo effect is there, and it's something that we need to worry about. C, evaluators of the response could influence outcomes if they know which subjects are in the treatment and which are in the control. And that's definitely a big problem. D, subjects in a study might react differently if they knew they were receiving an active treatment or a placebo. That is the placebo effect. So all of the above are reasons.
So it's E.
I wouldn't, there's no way to decide one way or the other just based on frequency. All are a concern. 8, the ocho. You're interested in determining which of 2 brands of tires, brand G and brand F, I don't know why G and F, whatever, which of these 2 lasts longer under differing conditions of use. 50 Toyota Camrys are fitted with brand G, and 50 Honda Accords are fitted with brand F. Each tire is driven 20,000 miles, and tread wear is measured for each tire, and the average tread of the 2 brands is compared. What's wrong with this design?
These 2 cars are different, so they put different tear, technically, and there's only 2 types of cars. So
okay.
Having
there be 2 types of car is definitely a concern, and the way that the tires were treated is kind of a concern. So what specifically is wrong with the way they treated the tires? And what did you have?
Well, they put 50 different ones on a Honda and 50 different ones on a Camry, and you could say that the Honda might add more wear to the tires regardless of which tire brand it is. So you should have 25 to
I do, but I'm waiting for you to explain
it. Okay. You should have 20. Okay, so the 50 Honda Accords, 25 of them can have the brand G and 25 can have the brand F. Or you take the same car and you put two different types of tires on each car.
You're thinking about the way we did the boots.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good.
That's what I would say. What
did you get? Come up with. So it sounds like what we're saying is definitely each brand of car should have both, or have conditions to test both brands of tires, right? Yeah. All right, so let's see what we have here. The type of car is a confounding variable. I think you're all saying that, right? Yeah. Average tread wear is not a proper measure of comparison. Well, it sounds pretty good, actually. The experiment should have been conducted with more than 2 brands of cars. Probably, but I think that with these 2 cars, we'll have a pretty good idea still. What else? Not enough of each type of tire was used in the study. 25 and 25, that's pretty good. Nothing is wrong with the design. It'll work quite well to compare the two brands of tires. So I think of those, the best response is A.
Yeah.
The best response is A. Although we ideally would like to test on more than two, and this is choice C, the best response, which takes the car make model under consideration, is choice A. Okay? Yeah.
I know the definition of confounding variable, but can you put an explanation in like a little bit of simple
example? Sure. Confounding variable is any variable that's not the explanatory variable, but has a an effect on the response. It's just that A also encompasses C. You know, we're just recognizing that there is problems with only using one type of car for one type of tire. Because although, you know, it's a problem that we only have two brands of cars, the bigger problem is that all cars of one make model receive only one type of tire. That's the bigger problem. Did it okay? Yeah. Okay. I won't. Number nine. Psychiatrist is studying the effects of regular exercise on stress reduction. She identifies 40 people who exercise regularly and 40 who do not. Each of these 80 people are given a questionnaire to designed to determine stress levels. None of the 80 people who participated in the study knew that they are actually part of a study. Which of the following is true? Okay. Is this an observational study?
Yes.
I think yes. B. Is this a randomized comparative experiment?
No.
No. Is this double blind?
No.
No. Is this match pair?
No.
No. Is this an experiment which exercise level is a blocking variable?
No.
No. In fact, it's not an experiment. Okay. It can't be blind if it's, you know, not an experiment, really, can it? Surveys tend to be are observational studies, yeah. So yeah, this is an observational study. Observational study. The subjects did not, or the researchers did not impose a treatment. And that's probably the big differentiation again. Do we tell the subjects what to do? If we tell the subjects what to do, then it's an experiment. 10. An electronics firm wants to survey its employees to determine their attitudes toward employee compensation. That's funny. They obtain a sample for the survey by randomly selecting the first 20, selecting one of the first 20 names. Sorry, I'm just making a notation. That's a typo. One of the first 20 names in an alphabetical list, and then selecting the 20th name on the list from there on after. We've talked about this a lot. This is a systematic sample. E. This is almost a definition of a systematic sample. Okay. Also to think about, this is not an SRS, since it is impossible to get, almost impossible to get two people whose ID numbers are close to enough to each other to be part of the same sample. Simple random sample, yeah. Which isn't the description, it's the name. In a simple random sample, every combination of subjects has the same probability of being selected. And 11, results of an experiment are said to be biased if, and that answer is B, by definition, outcomes that are outcomes are systematically favored over others. Can we talk 12?
By definition.
Yeah, basically that's the definition of biased. 12. A study shows that persons who ate 2 carrots a day have significantly better eyesight than those who eat less than 1 carrot a week. Which of the following statements are correct? Okay. So this is 1, 2, and 3. Be careful, try to pick. Don't try and pick ones that are too strong of an opinion. The study provides evidence that eating carrots contributes to better eyesight. The general health consciousness of people who eat carrots could be a confounding variable. This is an observational study, not an experiment. All three of those sound pretty good to me. Oh, no, I'm sorry. The first one doesn't sound good.
Yeah. So A, C, and 2.
So just 2 and 3. Now, the problem with 1 is that using the word contributes. Okay. Contributes makes it seem like this is a cause and effect relationship. This is not really a cause and effect relationship. This is a correlation. Okay. There is an association between carrots and better eyesight. But that's not causation. So choice 1 is an association between carrots and eyesight. Okay, although there is an association, this is not necessarily a cause and effect. Relationship. So, what was the correct answer?
D.
Questions on that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Third team are skipping, right? It's an easy question, right?
Okay.
Let's see. Starting from the beginning of this line, using single-digit labels, you assign the first four subjects to receive the new medication while the remainder receive the placebo. Which ones are receiving the placebo? That's the key on this one. Okay, so number one, Blumenthal is part of the treatment group, right? So treatment group, put a T next to Blumenthal. Next number, the first number is 8. So Tang, he's part of the treatment group. Blumenthal, he's part of the treatment group. The next digit is 5, House. House is part of the treatment group. The next number is a 0. Throw it out. The next number is a 7. Pavlikova. Pavlikova is part of the treatment group. Everybody else is part of the placebo group. Who's in the placebo group? Costello, Duval, Fan, and Long. But what is that? Blumenthal?
Blumenthal
House.
So if we were to do this problem, we'd have to do it the amount of times the random digits, or is the answer the same every time?
The answer would be the same every time for this one.
With the random digits.
Yeah, because the IDs have already been decided, and you just read the numbers from left to right to decide who's in the treatment group. Okay, Pavlikova.
Wouldn't that change the people that are in the placebo group? Because they're different numbers every time.
I know, we're always starting from the far left. Everyone has the same row of numbers.
Okay, so we would only use the first one?
We would use the first, I think, 5 digits.
And then
the rest of the digits are thrown away.
Most commonly used
answer. 8 is
Tang. Yeah, so that puts it on the.
So he's in our treatment group.
Yeah.
1 is Blumenthal. He's in our treatment group. Okay. And so we keep going until we pick 4 people in the treatment group.
Okay, yeah.
And then everybody else who we didn't pick is in the placebo group.
But every time we go on to another digit, like we go on to like the next set of numbers, there's a different people are in the placebo.
Yeah,
group.
But everyone, you always start from the far left.
Okay, and then the left.
That's all.
So we would only use the first 81507.
Yeah.
That's, and then the answer for the placebo group would be off of that one, not the remainder of the numbers.
The remainder of the numbers are junk.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you please review how you got, like, who was in the treatment group and who was in the placebo group?
Yeah, I'll do that one more time. Costello. Duval, Fan, and Long are the placebo group. Okay. So in order for you to kind of see exactly what we're doing, you have to kind of read along with me.
Okay.
It's up to you. Okay, so in order to do it, you have to kind of read along. The first number in the list is 8. 8 corresponds with the person named Tang. So Tang is going to be part of, so it says that we're going to assign the first 4 subjects to receive the medication. So the first 4 numbers that we get that are unique are going to be part of the treatment group. So we got an 8, Tang is treatment, and a 1, Blumenthal is treatment, and a 5, House is treatment. 0 we can't use, so we're going to ignore it. And then 7, Pavlikova is part of the treatment group. So we have 4 people that we've selected to be part of treatment. Everyone who we did not select is part of placebo.
So that's how you get the answer?
Yeah. Okay? All right, last. And it's before 5 o'clock, which is great. Sickle cell disease is a painful disorder of the red blood cells that affects mostly blacks in the United States. To investigate whether the drug hydroxyurea hydroxyurea can reduce the pain associated with sickle cell disease. A study by the National Institute of Health gave the drug to 150 sickle cell sufferers and a placebo to another 150. That's cruel. The researchers counted the number of episodes of pain reported by each subject. What is the response?
The number of episodes of pain.
Right.
Yay.
Since we are counting the number of episodes of pain, right?
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, the response variable is the number of episodes of pain. Okay? Now, I love to say that this is stats, and you shouldn't overthink things too much. That's usually when people get in trouble. Okay? It's not calculus. Don't be too analytical necessarily, or don't overthink it. Usually the answer is what it is.
What are the C and D? What would those be? Those would be variables.
The presence of sickle cell disease, that's a variable, but it's not confounding. So just extraneous. The drug hydroxyurea is our treatment. Yeah.
Wait, is our treatment also registered a mental variable?
Our treatment is always related to our explanatory variable. In a well-designed experiment.
Tomorrow is constantly going over FRC.
Yes. No, we didn't turn it in. I'm not collecting it. Any variable that doesn't have an effect on the response.
Hey, Mona, I could probably draw the line.
Is it extraneous variable?
Possibly,
yeah.
Or,
yeah. No. It's a variable that does not have an effect on the response.
But you can control it, right?
You can if it. You would only really want to control it if it has an effect on the response. Let me shut off this and then we'll talk, okay?
Oh, I just had a quick question.
Yeah. I don't want to record you asking your question.